Hello friends, welcome to a new lecture today. In this, we are going to learn about vestibular schwannoma, which is also called as acoustic neuroma. Vestibular schwannoma or acoustic neuroma. Among all the schwannomas which are present in our body, especially in the intracranial schwannomas, this vestibular schwannoma is the most common type of intracranial schwannomas. And these vestibular schwannomas are among 80% of all cerebellopontine tumors. See, we have, if you see, this is the brain, okay, and this is the midbrain, this is normal cerebrum, okay, this is the midbrain, then we have pons, then we have medulla oblongata. And surrounding this, in the posterior side, we have cerebellum. Okay, this is the cerebellopontine angle. At this cerebellopontine angle, the tumor which develops here is called as cerebellopontine angle tumors. And among all the cerebellopontine angle tumors, among 80% of them are acoustic neuromas or vestibular schwannomas. These account for almost 10% of all brain tumors. These acoustic neuromas are benign, they are encapsulated, and they are slow growing tumors. Because they are slow growing tumors, they are mainly locally invasive. And these acoustic neuromas are most commonly involves the inferior vestibular nerve. Among all the nerves, it most commonly involves inferior vestibular nerve followed by superior vestibular nerve followed by cochlear nerve nuclei. And this vestibular schwannomas can be both unilateral and bilateral. If it is bilateral, always and always suspect neurofibromatosis type 2. Because neurofibromatosis type 2, in neurofibromatosis type 2, one of the diagnostic criteria is bilateral vestibular schwannomas or bilateral acoustic neuromas. Then, these vestibular schwannomas originates from the schwann cells which are present in inferior vestibular nerve most commonly or superior vestibular nerve, and from these nerves these will progress to or they will go to the region called as Obersthener region, that is Obersthener Redlich zone, which lies in internal auditory canal. Okay, first they originate here and then they will lie in this Obersthener Redlich zone, which is present in internal auditory canal. Obersthener Redlich zone, present in internal auditory canal. So, first it arises from the inferior vestibular nerve and then it reaches the cerebellopontine angle. From this cerebellopontine angle, it erodes the internal auditory canal. Okay, and in the internal auditory canal and internal auditory meatus, from there to internal auditory canal. Anyways, anterosuperiorly, here in the anterosuperiorly, we have the fifth cranial nerve which is originating. So, if you were asked what is the earliest cranial nerve involved in acoustic neuroma, the earliest cranial nerve which is involved in acoustic neuroma is fifth cranial nerve, is the earliest cranial nerve which is involved. So, this will also, so if the fifth cranial nerve is involved, it will cause decreased corneal sensitivity. Corneal sensations are carried by fifth cranial nerve. So, if the fifth cranial nerve is involved, it causes decreased corneal sensitivity. Involvement of fifth cranial nerve is the earliest future. So, decreased corneal sensitivity is the earliest sign which you see in acoustic neuroma. This acoustic neuroma also involves seventh cranial nerves. In the seventh cranial nerves, sensory fibers are most commonly involved than motor fibers. If sensory fibers are most commonly involved, this will cause numbness in the posterior aspect of concha. And this numbness in the posterior aspect of concha is called as Histelberger sign, which is one of the sign in acoustic neuroma. Then, because of involvement of seventh nerve, it also causes loss of taste sensation, especially in the anterior two-third of the tongue. Then, it also, because the seventh cranial nerve also supplies the eye lacrimal gland, it causes decreased lacrimation is also seen because of the sensory involvement of seventh cranial nerve. Motor fibers are relatively more resistant to this acoustic neuroma damage. Then, this acoustic neuroma also involves 9th and 10th cranial nerves. Involvement of 9th and 10th cranial nerves causes dysphagia or in hoarseness of voice, because 10th cranial nerve, vagus nerve, with the help of recurrent laryngeal nerve and superior laryngeal nerve, it supplies the vocal cord. So it can also result that, so that there is compression of this nerve also results in hoarseness of voice. Then it can cause, because vagus nerve supplies the palate, it supplies the pharynx and laryngeal muscles. So this 10th cranial nerve involvement can cause palatal, pharyngeal and laryngeal paralysis is seen. Then in around 11th, if there is involvement of 11th, 12th, 3rd, 4th and 6th nerves are seen. If the tumor is very, very large, then these nerves are involved. Sometimes this tumor can also compress either the midbrain or the pons. When it compresses the midbrain or pons, it can lead to numbness of arms and legs, and it can also cause increased tendon reflexes. Then, sometimes this acoustic neuroma can also compress the cerebellum, resulting in ataxia. It can cause ataxic gait. Involvement of cerebellum can result in ataxic gait or inability to walk in straight line, or there can be problem in dysdiadokinesia, this test, or finger nose test, knee heel test can also be deranged if there is cerebellar involvement. Then, because there is a tumor in the cranial cavity, and if this tumor is larger in size, then it can increase the intracranial pressure, that is intracranial tension. Because of that, this can result in blurring of vision, and the patient complains with nausea and vomiting, or the patient can complain with headache, or diplopia can also be seen because of increased intracranial pressure. Increased intracranial pressure on fundus, if you do fundus examination, then this can result in papal edema because of increased intracranial tension. Then, if the tumor increases to such an extent, sometimes it can also cause herniation of cerebellar tonsils. This can result in herniation of cerebellar tonsils, and it can also cause compression to this pons and medulla. Thus, the vital centers which are present in the midbrain are also deranged. Can also be deranged. Then this is the involvement of the different structures anatomically. Then, if you were asked, this vestibular schwannoma is most commonly seen in the age group of 40 to 60 years. But if either it is bilateral or if it is associated with neurofibromatosis too, then the most common age group is 20 to 30 years. In neurofibromatosis 2 cases, it occurs earlier than normally. And this is mostly radioresistant tumor. In 90% of the cases, the acoustic neuroma is unilateral. Only in 10% of the cases, it is bilateral, and in those cases, it is associated with neurofibromatosis too. Then, most commonly, it shows unilateral sensory neural hearing loss in almost 95% of cases. It also presents with tinnitus in almost 65% of cases. In some, it is also presents with vertigo. Then, if you do histopathological examination, in histopathological examination, you see two types of patterns are seen in the histopathology. That is, we have I should draw with pink, but I don't have pink, so I'm drawing with this red color. Okay, some are in some the cells are so close to each other, they are tightly packed. In one pattern, the cells are tightly packed with each other, and this pattern is called as Antony A pattern, where the cells are closely packed with each other, which are spindle shaped cells with dense stained nuclei. Okay, and these types of cells, which are spindle-shaped cells, dense nuclei with closely or tightly packed cells, this is called as Verrucka bodies. These are called as Verrucka bodies. Then surrounding these cells, we also have loosely packed cells, which are seen. So there will be bundles of tightly packed cells will be seen. And also you see bundles of loosely packed cells surrounding them. Okay, these tightly packed cells are called as Antony A pattern, whereas the loosely packed cells surrounding this Antony A pattern are called as Antony B pattern. Okay, so this is how we see histopathologically. Then, if you see the classification of this acoustic neuroma, we have different grades of acoustic neuroma. So grade 1, here the size of the tumor in millimeters is 1 to 10, okay, and the extramietal size, that is the size outside the meatus, is small, whereas in grade 2 it is 11 to 22 mm and medium size. This is extramietal size. Then in grade 3 we have 21 to 30 mm and this is moderately large. Then in grade 4 this has 31 to 40 mm in size and extramietal size is large. And in grade 5 it has more than 40 mm in size and the extramietal size is giant. Okay, so this is how the acoustic neuroma is classified. Then if you see the investigations of acoustic neuroma, first you will have to do tuning fork tests. And in the tuning fork test, first if you do Rinne's test, this is mainly sensory neural hearing loss. Here, because in acoustic neuroma, the nerves are involved. Inferior vestibular nerve, most commonly followed by superior vestibular nerve, are involved. So it is sensory neural hearing loss. Tuning fork in Rinne's test in sensory neural hearing loss, it is positive. Weber's test in sensory neural hearing loss, it is towards the normal ear. It is lateralized towards the normal ear. And Squareback test in sensory neural hearing loss, it is shortened. And if you do speech discrimination score is poorly seen, then in pure tone audiometry, you see normal sensory neural hearing loss picture. And if you do tone decay is seen in more than 30 decibels, and recruitment phenomenon in this case is negative. And if you do BERA, BERA, that is brainstem evoked response audiometry, in this you see a delay of more than 0.2 milliseconds is seen in wave 5. You see a delay of 0.2 milliseconds is seen in wave 5 in BERA. Wave 5 mainly tells us about the nerve. So here the problem is in the nerve. Then this BERA is best test for acoustic neuroma. Then you can also do vestibular test, which is nothing but caloric test. If you do the caloric test, it shows decreased response is seen in the caloric test. Then investigation of choice for acoustic neuroma is gadolinium enhanced MRI. Investigation of choice is gadolinium enhanced MRI, which is 100% diagnostic. Then what is the treatment? The treatment of acoustic neuroma is surgery, is the treatment of choice for acoustic neuroma. Now we will learn about the surgical approaches. These surgical approaches are not that important, but it's good, it's worth knowing them. Then we have the approach, and there, when do we do it? Okay, now we have a retrosigmoidal approach. In retrosigmoidal approach, it is done if the patient has good hearing and if the patient has the tumor is larger, that is more than 3 centimeters, then you do this retrosigmoidal approach. Then we can also do middle cranial fossa approach. In middle cranial fossa approach, the patient should have good hearing, and here the tumor size should be less than 1.5 centimeters. If the tumor size is less than 1.5 centimeters, then you can do middle cranial fossa approach. Then we have retrolabyrinthine approach. This retrolabyrinthine approach is done for small cerebellopontine angle tumors which are not extending into the internal auditory canal. Then we have hearing ablation. Hearing ablation is, we have translabyrinthine approach is also present. This in translabyrinthine approach, this is suitable for tumors which are less than 3 centimeters in size. Okay, but these can lead to permanent sensory neural hearing loss. Then once you have excised the tumor, after tumor excision, you will have to look about hearing rehabilitation. How are we going to restore the hearing which is lost due to this surgery and due to this acoustic neuroma? In them, you should put a cochlear implant. Especially, the side effect is sensory neural hearing loss. This is overcome by cochlear implants. And we also have auditory brainstem implants are also available. These auditory brainstem implants are most commonly put in cases of bilateral acoustic neuroma. They are indicated in cases of bilateral acoustic neuroma, which is auditory brainstem implant. This acoustic neuroma can also be treated with gamma knife radiation or stereotactic surgery. In this gamma knife or stereotactic surgery, here the radiation is delivered with the help of cobalt 60 isomer. And this will deliver the radiation to the tumor. And this radiation will decrease the or arrest the growth of the tumor. So it is used in patients who refuse surgery. In them you can use this stereotactic surgery or gamma knife where radiation is emitted with the help of cobalt-60 isomer. The advantages of this gamma knife or stereotactic surgery is there is no morbidity which is associated with surgery, and here the seventh nerve function is preserved. And one more important thing is here hearing function is preserved. In surgical approach, there is sensory neural hearing loss which is reported because of the removal of tumor. But with the help of this gamma knife or stereotactic surgery, the hearing is preserved. There is also something called as cyber knife, which is recent procedure, which is a type of robotic surgery for acoustic neuroma. So in this acoustic neuroma, the symptoms classification, all those are important. Even if you do not remember this approach, that is fine, because questions are not asked in this part, but at least you should remember that with this approach, the most common side effect is sensory neural hearing loss, and because of that, we will have to do hearing rehabilitation after the surgery with the help of cochlear implants or auditory brainstem implants. Thank you guys for watching my lecture. Thank you.